What Amy is going to share with us today is some of her experience and her design philosophy and her own arc of learning having to do with aspects of the kinds of connected learning, integrative thinking by means of digital fluency that we've been talking about thus far in the week. So she will be talking about a specific course in Soviet history, but we're talking about it in terms of her own learning, her students' learning, and what it was like to try to learn to do it this way, or do part of it this way. A lot of interesting moving parts, but also, I have to say, one of the best teachers I've ever met to be able to share this experience with us. So Amy Nelson is a colleague of mine, but I used to work with her at Virginia Tech, where she is an associate professor of history. Her research work is on Soviet history, and most recently on domestication, with a particular Soviet aspect of domesticated animals sent up into space. So space dogs and that whole program. And she teaches a wide variety of courses at Virginia Tech, including courses that will be in the new general education curriculum there. And I think I said already she's extraordinary.
So thank you for that wonderful introduction, and it's really an honor and a pleasure to be with you all today, and a warm greeting to Tom and John and Gardner and Danielle, who I understand is also there. As Gardner said, I'm a historian of modern Russia with a particular interest in musicians and animals, which I realize is an unlikely combination of research interests. And I'm very resistant to kind of the binaries that one tends to bump up against when you study things like Russian history. So I don't see Russia as being an inherently backward, dark counterpart to a U.S. force of progress and light. I don't see animals as being fundamentally different from humans. I see us as being on a continuum and a spectrum of experience and existence. And my approach to pedagogy is very much in that vein. I always have seen engagement, research, learning, teaching as being integrated with each other and implicated in each other. And at a time when our education system focuses so much energy on salvation by STEM and on quantification and on testing, I'm really committed to supporting the development of the whole person through higher ed and not just guaranteeing them a fat paycheck. And I think we humanists have to deliver on that commitment by helping students develop the kinds of critical faculties, cultural sensitivities, and ethical sensibilities they need to serve their communities. So for me, it's the nuances, it's the shades of gray that help us appreciate the contingency of our own experience. And as a teacher, what really gets me going is when students, by studying the past in a more complicated way, come to appreciate the complexities and contingencies of their own experience. So Gardner may have sent out a link to a Google Doc, and it's also available on Twitter with the hashtag networked course. So almost everything I'm referring to in the next little bit will be linked from that doc, and please feel free to explore and to look around. Websites for all of my network courses are available off of my home website, which is amynelson.net, so everything I'm talking about can ultimately be found that way as well if you can't get to the Google Doc. So I've always been a fan of active learning. I've always been committed to critical engagement with sources. I've always been dedicated to cultivating analytical writing, and because these are the kinds of skills that help students make sense of the world around them. They're still at the core of my teaching praxis, but over the last couple of years, that praxis has undergone a pretty significant transformation as I've realized how networked learning environments can amplify the kinds of outcomes that I want my students to take away with them. So what I want to do now is briefly share with you my experience with hybrid networked courses. So these are courses where they're largely elaborated online on blogs that are syndicated to a mother blog, but they have a face-to-face component as well. And there are kind of two sections to this, or three sections to this. The first part, I'm going to just kind of briefly go over how I went from thinking about shifting from taking a course to making a course. And then after that, I'll talk a little bit about the specific design of the course that I use in case you want to try this at home, although you'll probably have better ideas than I've had about how to make it work for your particular field. And then I, at the end, if we have time, I want to talk a little bit about assessment, because I think this kind of course format lends itself particularly well to the kinds of assessment and the kinds of formative and summative assessments that we should be looking for and that are far more central and profound than the kind of counting and quantification approaches that many of us are subjected to. Okay, so far so good. How it all began. In the spring of 2013, Gardner, whose faculty development seminar I sort of stumbled into the right before classes started in the spring semester, helped me figure out how to reinvent an upper level honor seminar that I occasionally get to teach and that is a real highlight of my teaching life. So these are honor students, they come from all across the university. And this course is called Deep History and Domestication, The Animal Side of Human Life. And its goal was to look at the history of humans' relationships with domestic animals since humans began being humans and animals became domesticated. And Gardner helped me see that doing this using a mother blog to kind of shape the work of the seminar might be an interesting way to amplify the kind of discussion and kinds of engagement that we might have. And so with very little notice, like 48 hours, because I'm one of those people who procrastinates and never gets ready for class until the absolute final moment, I learned how to make a mother blog and do enough WordPress that I could go into class on Tuesday morning and tell my students that we were embarking on a great experiment. The rules were very simple. I told the students that the course isn't something that you take, it's something that you make. I told them that we were going to make this one together on our blogs. I made sure they knew I was making it up as I went along. And it was definitely a great adventure. So remember, I had never blogged before. I had learned and forgotten HTML several times. I managed to set up my mother blog. Gardner showed me how to aggregate all of the comments from the individual blogs through a single RSS feed so that the comments could be fed into the front of the blog. And I can talk about that later if you like in more detail or explain my rationale for doing it that way. But basically, on the slide, you can see how simple and how skeletal, really, the instructions were for the students' blogging assignments, right? So they had to post once a week about the assigned readings. I didn't tell them how much. I didn't tell them how long. I didn't tell them what to say. There were assigned readings, and I said we would talk about them in class. But I didn't say, you know, you must do 500 words, or you must cite 3 outside sources, or you must use an image. I did none of that. I told them that they needed to comment on another person's blog at least twice a week, and that what I really wanted them to do was engage the readings thoughtfully and substantively, and just to explore and play with the medium. And what I found was that I had just kind of jumped into this 24/7 learning environment that outperformed a conventional seminar format, which would be reading, reflection papers, weekly meetings, discussion leaders, my sage words of wisdom, all on a weekly schedule. But I found that this new mode outperformed that old mode in 3 really important ways. So the first was that the quality of the distributed conversation was just much better and much more significant than anything I'd ever experienced in a face-to-face class. I realized that students wrote better when they were in conversation with each other than they did when they were just writing for the teacher. I'd always thought that they did their best work for me because I was giving them a grade. And I'll talk more about that later. But one of the early lessons of this process for me was that the grade is not the main thing, right? The main thing is the conversation and the intellectual exchange. So when their peers were their primary audience, when they were writing for each other and trying to get traction with each other, they leveled up. They wrote long, detailed, analytically sophisticated posts. Their comment discussions were engaging and wonderful. On the slide, you can see excerpts from comments from the first round of discussions that we did, the first comments on the blog. So before we had ever had our first real class meeting, we had all of these viewpoints sort of coming into the mix, and this multilateral conversation with students from all across the university coming at the same topic, which was Jared Diamond's blanking on his on the title. Right, Guns, Germs, and Steel. Thank you very much. Anyway, I went to class on that first day, very excited by what had happened on the blogs, but also with some trepidation because I was afraid that we wouldn't have anything to talk about during the class, because they would be all talked out on the blogs. So I was afraid that they would have nothing to say, that everything had already been said, but instead we had this just incredibly wonderful conversation. And at the end of the class, one of my students said, "This was the best discussion I've had in a class forever. I'm just really sorry that we don't have notes." And I stopped for a minute and tried to pick my jaw up off the floor because everybody was already standing up and starting to leave. And I said, "Yeah, it was really great, wasn't it? It would be wonderful to have notes." And we all kind of looked at each other, and people looked mildly interested. And I said, "So who wants to be the note keeper next week?" And then everybody started packing up again. And so the person who had made the suggestion said, "Oh no, I wasn't thinking that we would have a note taker. I think we should have a Google Doc, and we can all be on it at the same time, and we can all participate. And that way we can annotate our discussion, and we'll have a transcript of what we said, and we'll have links and things to the cool stuff that we mentioned." And I said, "Okay, let's go," right? And this was just one of those serendipitous, amazing moments that really changed the course. So if you have access to the links from the Google Doc, you can check and see what those discussions look like. The process that we came up with involved me setting up the doc ahead of class. We would all get on the doc and work on the doc during class, and then after class, I would walk back across the drill field, download the doc, save it as a PDF, and put it on the website. The slide that you're looking at now gives you just a small sense of what the engagement was like, so how much editing was happening on these documents. So class was between 2 and 4 on Tuesday afternoon, and so you can see just between 3:13 and 3:18, you've got whatever, 6-7 edits by 3 or 4 different people, which is wonderful because, of course, that many people can't talk at once. If you go look at one of the docs, you'll see that they are, on the one hand, kind of all over the place, but on the other hand, very deeply layered, interesting associative trails of the kinds of things you might think about if you were talking about deep history and domestication. And then the other sort of unanticipated and completely wonderful thing about this is that people continued to use it out after class. So along with the blogs, using the Google Docs helped me realize that the class was not just Tuesday from 2 to 4, it was all the time. So in this revision history on the right side of the slide, you can see that, so the last person to edit during class was Casey at 3:50. I came back to my office and downloaded it at 4:30, cleaned it up and downloaded it at 4:35. But then later on the next day, and even a couple of days after that, other members of the class were back on that doc, looking at it, changing things, and working with it. So the other thing I want to mention here before I go on is that very early on in this, I realized that it was important for me to blog as well, that decentering myself as the kind of the instructor who was delivering content. If we were creating this course together, then I needed to have skin in the game. And since we were all commenting on each other's blogs and posts, it didn't seem fair for me not to be posting as well. So I started doing that, and it was a ton of fun, and I never looked back. I was very, very glad that I did that, and I've kept that up right up until the present. So the quality of the distributed conversation was wonderful. The quality of the in-class discussion was amazing. And then the other transformative, wonderful amplifier that the blogs gave us was the web-based research project. So instead of having students do a traditional term paper or what I had done before, which was have them do a kind of web-based thing inside our learning management system, which was a pain in the neck because it didn't work very well, the changes always got messed up, it was ugly and not aesthetically very satisfying, and people cheated and that made me crazy. So having them do it on their own blogs that were also a research project, you know, just seemed to open the door for their creativity, for them to really pursue their kinds of research interests. It made it really easy for us to workshop the projects together. We did a lot of that on Google Docs before they went live on the blogs. And you can see from this slide the sort of range of things that they came up with just in terms of presentation and style, right? So everybody had a domesticated animal. We had a guy who did bees. The horse project was fabulous. When Man Meets Reindeer was also a showstopper. On the Google Doc that I sent you, I put links to some of the projects that had especially spectacular web interfaces, including the one about pigeons and the one about chickens. And if you ever wanted to know about chicken domestication, I highly recommend that you consult that project. So further evidence that these research projects kind of gave us so much more leverage and so much more opportunity for connected learning than a typical research paper would have became very clear on the last day of class when we decided that instead of doing final presentations, since we had all read each other's stuff and been working with each other's stuff all semester, we decided we didn't need to do final presentations. So we had a final feast and course awards session. And so for the final feast, you had to bring something for the class, something edible, that was either inspired by, made from, or could be fed to the animal you studied all semester. And they came up with just incredible things. And my favorite was the guy who did goldfish, whose work is showcased here. He took marshmallows and dipped them in blue icing, dusted them with graham cracker crumbs, and put goldfish crackers and little silver sprinkles on them so that each marshmallow actually looked like a little goldfish bowl. So that was pretty cool. You can see the reindeer cookies right there next to it. But in class, we also decided that we needed categories for awards that we hadn't anticipated we would need. So one of them was best video featured on a research project blog. And there you can see just by the titles of those videos what kind of a range we had to choose from there. Which came first, the chicken or the egg, is a scientific, you know, popular science, very good animated video on YouTube. George Carlin on cats sort of speaks for itself. The Amazing Trick Goldfish is, I'm not kidding, a video of a goldfish that jumps through hoops and does other kind of extraordinary tricks for a food lure. And then the other thing that I never thought I would talk about in a seminar was best poem featured in a research project blog. And here the finalists were this Egyptian ode to embryos, which we decided meant eggs. We had a long discussion about embryo and eggs in the context of ancient Egypt, an excerpt from the Iliad, and a poem written to commemorate a heroic passenger pigeon from World War I. In short, you know, in terms of the depth of analysis, the use of various media, the breadth of the source base, but most of all in their appeal to the reader, you know, these were research projects that I wanted to read. These were not the term paper projects where I would sit there going, oh my God, I can't believe I have to sit down and, you know, plow through 20 pages of this stuff. These were engaging, compelling, very high level projects. So in all of these ways, this kind of work seemed to excel and be far superior over the kinds of assignments I'd done for the first 20 years of my teaching career. So that course, Deep History and Domestication, was really my kind of gateway drug, I would guess. And I was really hooked. I was hooked on the power of a networked learning environment, and I was done with conventional reflection papers and term papers. And so that fall, I used what I'd learned in deep history and domestication to transform one of my bread and butter courses. And that is an upper level survey of Soviet history. So I embraced the make a course ethos more vigorously. I jettisoned the lecture discussion format of content delivery in favor of having students create most of the content on their blogs. And my undergraduate editorial assistant and I curated the submissions into a themed edition about a particular time period of Soviet history. I'll talk more about the design for the course in the next section, and I'll give you a little tour of the mother blog then, because it's very intuitive to me now, but I realize it isn't if you haven't encountered it before. Again, if you can get to the link to the course from the fall of 2014 or the fall of 2013, all the documents for the course are there, and you can learn a lot by just sort of poking around. So feel free to do that. So what this new course, the 20th Century Russia course, had multiple goals. And one of them was to bridge the kind of information silos that students encounter, that we all encounter as researchers. So what I wanted was for them to create the course content in their blog posts on a weekly basis, sort of divided into these chronological chunks. But I wanted them to use high value materials for those posts. And I wanted them to be able to work with a range of things from a variety of sources. So I wanted them to use the open web. I wanted them to use print resources. And I wanted them to use proprietary databases, which in my field is especially important, right? Because most students of Russian history don't speak Russian. But there are these very good specialized databases available for people who are able and willing to go find them, and at libraries that are willing to pay for them. And so I wanted students to have advantage of these kinds of specialized databases, along with all of the riches of the open web and this online primary materials archive, which is called 17 Moments in Soviet History. So this slide shows you the textbook that I use, which is just a good basic text. It's just kind of a safety net background. You know, it's never on the test. It's just there to keep you from getting lost. 17 Moments in Soviet History, which is an openly accessible archive of primary source materials. It's a fabulous resource. It was the target of a really vicious hack over Christmas and is not online right now, but will be back up in a couple of months. And then on the lower right of that slide, you see the screenshot from the Eastview database that we use really extensively, which is called the Current Digest of the Russian Press, which is English translations of Russian publications, news publications, going back to 1949. So this is something we picked up about halfway through the course, and people just started being able to use it, and it was actually really wonderful. So when I do the different screen share here in a minute, I'll show you what that looks like as well. Okay, so the results of that experiment, you know, I called it silos to surf, right? So getting the high value proprietary bases out of the silo of the library and onto the surf of the open web really changed my view of the classroom and my place in it. I'm still very committed to the procedural norms of my discipline, knowing how to find a source, contextualize it, put it in conversation with secondary literature, craft an analytical framework that goes beyond description or recitation. These are the things that matter to me. And teaching in the make a course mode showed me how to empower students to produce knowledge and analyze complex historical issues in a way that left the opportunities for future discovery and engagement open. And I think that was what was so cool, this idea that this was only the beginning. This was a course format that put students in charge of their learning. It encouraged them to pursue their own interests. At the same time, it stimulated collaboration, peer-to-peer mentoring. It engages students directly in the research process from the very get-go, from the first day of class. And I think it can be adapted to any field where the research methodology involves identifying high-value source materials, analyzing them critically, and presenting one's findings in a cogent and compelling way. So what I've done is especially suitable and easy to do for history, but I'm quite sure it could be done for any number of humanities disciplines as well. So I want to end this part with a brief story, which is Kelsey's story. So I thought that I kind of had it. You know, we were 3 weeks into the Soviet history course, things were going very well. And then at the end of class, one of the best students in the class came up to me and said, you know, I'm just wondering what I could do better. You know, I don't think I'm really performing at my potential, and what could I do better? And I, you know, looked, I'm sure, confused and said, you're doing great. You know, your posts are among the best in the class, and everybody loves them, and you've been in the slider several times, and things are just wonderful. And she said, no. She said, I really like this. I think I could be really good at it. I want to do more. How could I do more? So I said, okay, well, everybody could be better, right? So I said, if you wanted to do more, you could look at these sources. You could do this kind of citation. Here are some other places that you can look. You can start your posts a little earlier in the week so that you have more time to revise them before they're due. And she promptly went off and did all of those things. And this is a screenshot of her blog here. And I guess what Kelsey taught me in that moment was, you know, meet your students where they are, you know, and often that's about kind of lowering your expectations, but it shouldn't be, right? Meet them where they are and expect greatness, right? Why should I have not expected greatness from her? She was clearly great. She had great potential. She was great to begin with, and she had great potential. So that to me was one of the kind of big turning points of this whole thing. Okay, would you like to take a break? Would you like me to get unmuted so that we could do questions for a little bit?
Good question. Do you think the fact that you had upper level and honor students played a large role in the success? Do you see this working with lower, maybe not so much geared towards honor students?
I didn't get that.
I'll repeat it.
Yeah.
How well do you think this would work with lower level students, given you had honors level students? And then I'll mute us while you respond.
Okay. I think it would work great. So the honors level students, that was just the first course. That was deep history and domestication. Soviet history is up to 40 students, and it is it's a 3,000 level course, but it's open to non-majors, and it works great.
How did she use things like
the
text?
So the question, Amy, is how did you use other non-digital materials as part of the experience you were now building?
When they were encouraged to use print materials, when they cited their textbook, obviously they were supposed to, when they used material from their textbook, obviously they were supposed to cite that. Many of them did use other print materials as well, and they just needed to cite it on their posts. One of the things that the blog post made so easy was citation. What I liked was that they sort of realized it's often easier to hyperlink to something than it is to, you know, get a citation of a print thing and put it in there, but that both are important, right? That these are skills that they need to have.
Right, so maybe Tim's question is more this way, and I'll get him to correct me if I'm wrong. They could use many different sources, but what did you do to scaffold or arrange or construct their way through the readings? Did you assign passages from a textbook? Did you assign particular readings? Is that getting at the spirit of your question or not? Okay, I think that's what Tim's asking.
Right. So I left them, the assignments are very open. They're very, very open-ended. In fact, let me go down here. Let me go to the next. This is a good segue to the next bit. So the blog post guidelines are on the, for a sample week, are on this slide, right? And they're very open-ended. So basically, I just give them a time period. We're pretty far into the course at this point, so we're using 17 moments in Soviet history. I encourage them to look at the text and, you know, give them some sort of ideas about how to do that. But the magic of this is actually in the open-ended nature of it. So what I found is that pointing them towards high-value materials, but then letting them explore on their own and use what they find, because they often find things better than what I find, makes for really, really good, really good posts. Does that help?
I think so, yes. And just so you know where we are in terms of how we're navigating, I was not able to share the link to the Google Doc that you shared with me with everyone prior to your being here today, but it is now up on the seminar mother blog under the readings and viewings tab. So if you have a computer, if it's connected to the internet, if you're so inclined, and you want to be able to look at some of these things while Amy is speaking, just go to rampages.us/seminarians unite, and you will see on the readings viewings tab, there is now a link to Amy Nelson's Google Doc. Are there other questions you want to ask Amy before she goes into some of the next part of what she's going to share? So logistically, what was the class meeting schedule for this 20th century Russia class?
So it's scheduled as a twice a week, 75 minutes. And usually we probably met twice a week, maybe 40 to 50% of the time. We met twice a week, always at the beginning of the term. Closer to the end of the term, we didn't so much. And sometimes we would just meet for 20 or 30 minutes. Okay, so I hope you can now see this is the main course blog for the fall 2014 class. And I'll just give you kind of a quick tour of it, right? So this is the mother blog. It's the gateway to the course. All of the students are syndicated to it. So here are all of them. You can see that they come up with really wonderful titles for their own blogs, like Pass the Vodka, Comrade, and The Kolkhoz, and Keep Calm and Pass the keep just putting in my two cents about Russian history. All of the documents for the course and the kind of overview of the course are here. So the syllabus and the guidelines for the blogging basics are here, and you're welcome to use that as you will. So everyone's syndicated to this. They post once a week. Everything comes in over the weekend, and it just is syndicated as a post. Then I have an editorial team that curates this into a weekly edition. So the very best posts, the posts that the editorial team deems the best, get red stars, right? And so we categorize them as red stars here. And the very best of the red star posts go in the slider up here. So this is one of these things that students love and that I didn't appreciate until I did it, right? Which is that it's one thing to get an A on your paper or a check plus on your reflection or whatever. But when you come to class and you find out that your post is featured in the slider, it's like being above the fold on the New York Times, right? Everybody knows that you did great, right? And it's not a zero-sum game. We often give out more red stars. There are only 6 or 7 spots in the slider, but we often give out many more red stars than that. So it's not competitive in that sense. And we do, if somebody's been in the slider 2 or 3 times, then we'll probably give somebody else a turn, you know, just to share and share alike. This gray area is for the Students' Choice Award. So we all, as a class, collectively pick a post to be in this featured spot. This one had some formatting issues, so the image didn't come through. But you can see it's just it's a very good, this is at the end, right? And just to give you a sense of how, I don't know if you can read this, how good these comment threads can be, right? So this is the end of the class, everybody's running out of steam maybe a little bit, you've got some kind of good but somewhat perfunctory comments, right? Fantastic post, great post, blah, blah, blah. But then you get this. My uncle was stationed in Berlin during Ronald Reagan's speech. While Mr. President was making the speech, no one knew what could happen, and they were prepared for the worst. He couldn't really tell me a lot. But great post. I really wish Boris Yeltsin would have been a stronger character, and maybe Russia would have been a strong democracy today. So in other words, you know, bringing this experience to this discussion enriches us all, right? We wouldn't have had that if we didn't have the blog, and if they weren't doing the discussions on the blog. So slider, student's choice. The left-hand corner is mine. I call it Mother Blog Central. This is where I issue Mother Blog Central directives, which include the weekly blog guidelines. So they're instructions for the week, which as you've seen are pretty general. And then I do a kind of retrospective of the week when the edition is ready to go. So that's, you know, organizationally how that works. We also use Google Docs and a Twitter stream to stay in touch. So I have a Twitter feed for Soviet history. Anything that I put up there comes in. It's a way for me to stay in touch with them between sessions. And then I do put the sources that they're going to be using most often, I put on the blog so that they're easy for them to find. But, you know, this one, which we spend a lot of time with, is the one that requires a login, and it's, you know, it's easy to use as those kinds of databases go, but by the end of the semester they're using them quite proficiently. Okay, so I just wanted to kind of give you a sense of what the mother blog looked like. Do this. There we go. All right. So let's see what else. So the mother blog is basically the course, right? They have their own blogs, which become an e-portfolio of their posts. Many of them have said that they use these after the class. Some of the ones that I enjoy the most are here. I really like Quit Stalin and Read My Post. This just gives you an example of the kinds of comment threads that we get that are that can be very, very rich. This post, which is about women aviators in World War II, was 1,000 words long. She used sources from the historical New York Times, Wikipedia, The Telegraph, and this really wonderful blog about Russian Orthodoxy in the U.S. that she found on her own. It was not something that was suggested to her. Another area where I saw the value of the distributed discussion come in was the very first week. So this is from the fall of 2013. I had a student who posted about Jews in the Pale of Settlement, right, which is in Eastern Europe, Belarus, Poland, Galicia, sort of that area. And the assignment that week had been to start with an image. So there are these beautiful colorized images at the Library of Congress by the Tsar's last photographer, and she chose an image of Jewish children going to school in Samarkand, which of course is not in the Pale of Settlement. So this very first night, this post got so many comments, had 10 comments in less than 3 hours, including two from me. One of them referenced another student's post. And along the way, I was able to first gently and then more directly get the author of the post to acknowledge that the photograph was not about Jews who were in the Pale, but about Jews somewhere else. And then she updated her post, right? Which is another terrific thing about the blogs, right? I think we have this idea that, you know, if you make a mistake, it's terrible, or it's out in public, and so, you know, that's awful, and, you know, people will know how bad you are. And it's actually quite the opposite, right? It's out in public so people can see how good you are. You're learning to how to have a professional discussion in a public arena, which is a very valuable skill to have. And you're learning how to respond to feedback and to fix things. And you're learning that your first impression might not be your last impression, and that your views on something might change. So that was really good. And then just one more example of kind of the magic of the public distributed course is that this post on the Emir of Bukhara, so this is from that same week, first week of class in fall of 2013, class ended in December, and in May of 2014, someone who claims to be the only living male descendant of the last emir of Bukhara found this post and commented on it. And the author wrote me and said, oh my gosh, can go check out my blog. You won't believe who's checking in there, right? Okay, so this is about, let me see. Yeah, I want to talk about the I want to talk about the editorial team. So we do use social media to stay in touch between sessions. One of the most best unanticipated learning amplifiers of this whole project has been the editorial team. And it started with my terrific first editorial assistant in the fall of 2013, Ben, who had taken deep history and domestication with me, but was also a Russian studies student and had had Soviet history. So he took Soviet history in the first run through of the blogging project and was my editorial assistant. So we did all of the content curating together, because the real time intensive part of this is getting the weekly edition into shape, right? Reading the posts, commenting on the posts, tagging the posts, putting them in categories, getting the images into the slider, getting them formatted properly, and all of that. So I asked Ben if he was interested in, you know, being a blog master, and he says, oh, I've always wanted to be a blog master. And so he was just a huge lifesaver and learned a lot and benefited tremendously from the experience. He blogged himself during the course. He's now on a full fellowship at Chapel Hill, pursuing an MA in Russian studies, and is very grateful for his WordPress skills. He learned a lot about peer-to-peer mentoring. He was just the right mix of being very gentle and being very smart and very, very competent. So he then helped me recruit from that class three people who helped me in the fall of last year. So one of the lessons I learned the first year was that one editorial assistant was great, and if that person was Ben, you might actually survive, but really you needed more. So I had three last semester, and that was about right. So I had one for 38 students, and I had three for 25 students. And this fall, I've got two for about 30 students, and I think that'll be a good mix. Just as an example of how we sort of ended up on the last day of the first year, one of the students who would become one of the lead editorial assistants the next year brought kvass to class on the last day. And probably not a lot of you have had kvass, although maybe some of you had, but it's a mildly alcoholic Russian peasant beverage made from fermented rye bread. And because of globalization and because Blacksburg's a funny place, you can actually buy 2-liter bottles of it in our world market. So Courtney brought kvass to class on the last day to accompany the donuts that I always bring on the last day. So the question is, you know, what do you do with the face-to-face time? And there are kind of two activities here. One is we build on the blog, right? So we use what we did on the blog to figure out what's going to be in the weekly edition. We talk about particular posts. We talk about issues that have come up in the comment threads. We choose the student choice post. I do a lot of clarifying, right? So one of the things you learn is that if two or three people post on the same topic, they often come to very different conclusions. And that's really a good thing, because it gives you a chance to discuss different interpretations of the same issue or the same event. And then we also prepare for the next round. So we find and work with sources, and this is where working with those databases becomes very important, right? And this is, I'd like to do this as a completely online class at some point, but I haven't quite figured out how to make this piece work, because the kind of face-to-face of working with the databases, I think it will be kind of tricky. The posts build in complexity over the semester, you know, so we start with an image and then I say, okay, why don't you try to do this? You know, so we gradually add things. We have make sessions where we make interactive timelines, we make memes, and of course Soviet history has such great propaganda that you know, memes are fun to are very fun to make, and I'm always amazed at what they come up with. We spend some time throughout the semester doing blog beautification, which is, you know, making your blog look nice. I'm very careful to never call it WordPress instruction because I don't believe in that. I believe in helping students learn how to make, you know, make their content more appealing and more engaging. And I'm, you know, that's what we sort of focus those sessions are on. And then in parentheses, you'll see that I do still lecture. And I have to say this was disappointing to me. When I first started this, I thought, okay, making a course means I won't lecture anymore. It means I won't tell them what Russian history is. It means they will create Russian history. And then I realized, after they rebelled on me a couple of times, that this was just not a tenable position. And so what I do is I lecture from their blog posts. I use what they give me. And then I do give them a kind of I show them how what they've done fits into a particular narrative arc so that they have some kind of scaffolding to hang on to so that they have a sense of the whole rather than just the pieces, right? Because they have a blog post, they have a blog with 10 posts about 10 particular moments, but, you know, I have the expertise, the experience, and the vantage point to show them how that all sort of hangs together and how it connects with what their classmates are doing. So I do lecture reluctantly and not very much, but maybe once a week for 20 minutes or so. Okay, let's see. I know we're close to out of time, and I want to talk a little bit about assessment. Oh, their sense of humor never ceases to amaze me, right? So this slide gives you a sense of their how good they are with titles. They realize that people are more likely to read their posts and they're more likely to get nominated for things if they have catchy titles. So they do Give Me Latvia or Give Me Death and Cornflakes for Comrades and Don't Stand So Close to Me, which is actually about the Sino-Soviet split. And then this quote, which is about a balalaika player riffing on an electric guitar, I think is just really wonderful. So one of the best things that they do is bring in their own experience. So some of them do get to go to Russia. Some of them, we have a big ROTC program here, and many of them were in Estonia two summers ago. And so this post, which is on the Google Doc, I hope you'll have a look at it. And if you get a chance, just click on the link about this at the bottom of the post. That is the Estonian national anthem with almost a million people singing it. It really will almost give you goosebumps. It's pretty incredible. Okay, so assessment. As a humanist, I am committed to cultivating the kind of fine-grained qualitative engagement with the past that resists simple yardsticks and quantification. I'm much more interested in the kinds of sources and how students interpret them than I am with how many they find or how many words they write about them. And I find with students that I'm always working against the does this count, how much does this count, is this going to be on the test, fill in the box mentality that they've been subjected to for the first 12 years of their educational life. So how do I grade this? You know, how do I assess it? The answer is carefully and holistically as possible. Their individual portfolio and posts are worth about half of the final grade, and 20% is for commenting, and they have to comment at least 3 times a week. They get lots of formative feedback from me, the editors, and each other over the term. So because I read everything, I don't comment on everybody's post every week, but they probably get a comment from me every other week. Every person probably gets a comment from me every other week. But my comments are never, this is wrong or I wish you'd done this better. It's, I really like how you connected to this issue that so-and-so wrote about in his blog. Or it would be interesting to think about how your interpretation of this fits with so-and-so's interpretation of this, right? So I try to put them in conversation with each other and engage the issues, because for me that's much more rewarding and for them it's much more meaningful, right? Plus you can't you can't grade them on a public open thing. So we don't do that. It takes them a while to kind of get on board with this. Here are the blogging basics, right? I tell them they have to do it 9 times. I tell them there's no assigned format, and I have this, you know, in big letters, that individual posts are not graded, but will be considered holistically as evidence of your general commitment. And yet, you know, they still, you know, really, especially at first, they really want to know, like, how am I doing? How am I doing? How am I doing? So it's always good when you get to the end and you get comments like this when they do their assessment of the course, right? So this is from some, I don't know who this is, but it made me sleep better that night. She says, I love the structure of this class. See, I do think it's a she. Even though I am OCD about knowing my grades and am used to a rigid scale, I wish more professors would implement something like this because I think we end up learning more than if we just memorize information for a test. I will be the first to say I memorize it all the night before, enough to get a good grade, and then forget it a week later. Thank you for trying something new. Okay, so what do you do for tests then? This was an incremental development for me. So when I started with the create a course, make a course thing, I then would come to a test and think, oh my gosh, here I've got this midterm from the old me, and how am I going to do that? It took me a while to figure this out, but now what I do is I use the midterm, I have them use their blog posts as the jumping off point for their midterm. So the only things they turn in to me directly for a grade that just comes from me are 2 midterms and a final. But the final is really a self-assessment. And here you can get a sense of the kinds of things that I ask them to do on the midterm. So I ask them to talk about the post that they think represents their best work and write a 2-page essay about how it illuminates or connects to one of the broader themes of the course. So I'm asking for them to, you know, to do that sort of synthetic work. And I'm asking them to use materials from elsewhere in the course. And then, some of you have heard this from me before, but one of my great heroes in life is a man named Ian Duncan, who's an emeritus professor from the University of Guelph. He studies applied ethology and animal behavior and has been instrumental in helping improve conditions for livestock and farm animals, and particularly poultry. And his whole thing was, you know, that a lot of what's done to animals in modern agriculture is done on the assumption that you don't really know what's going on with them. You know, you don't really know that the chicken is unhappy in the little tiny cage. You don't know that the pig is unhappy because it can't lay down. You don't know that the veal calf is unhappy because it's separated from its mother, etc. And so he developed this idea of the preference test, where you give them the choice, right? So you give the chicken the choice of staying in the little cage or jumping up on the roost, and you give the sow the choice of being eating only when confined in a stall or going back and hanging out with her friends. So I figured that if it was good for chickens, it would probably be good for students too, you know? So I should ask them what they think they've learned. And so now I administer an instrument at the end of every semester asking them what they think they've learned. And these next couple of slides give you a sense of what they say, right? They love the chance to learn more about Russian history on their own. They liked the freedom to write about topics they didn't know about. They thought blogging made it easy to grasp and remember key information. They thought getting to build a digital portfolio that we can keep after we finish the class was good. The most rewarding part of the blogging was seeing my posts and those of my classmates on the mother blog. It was nice to see my contributions alongside my classmates' posts come together into a well-rounded final product. Being able to proudly share my own work and receive constructive feedback from my peers and professor. I never got that kind of those kinds of comments on my evaluations before this. So I also asked them on the exit survey, and this is an anonymous instrument, I asked them what they think about the development of their blog, and this gives you a sense, you know, the bottom quote, I didn't really know what I was doing at first, this is my first history class, definitely happy I took it. And I really haven't done a lot of research through my college career, so this was definitely a learning experience. I think that my blog has changed over the semester into something that shows that I am a good researcher. I tried to pick topics I was interested in so I would take more time on them and enjoy writing the blog. And then finally, I asked them if they think blogging will be useful to them, or being knowing WordPress and being able to blog will be useful for future employment in grad school. And not all of them think it is, but an awful lot of them do. More than two-thirds of them do. And so they say things like you see on this slide. So I know we're just about out of time, and what I would like to end with is a couple of YouTube videos. Students have always loved my war stories. So I started going to the Soviet Union in the mid-80s and went fairly regularly for 20 years. I haven't gone for the last 3 years, but they love my stories of my adventures, and especially those from the 80s and the early 90s. The Gorbachev era really fascinates them. And so I've long used this Pizza Hut commercial to talk about how Soviet public opinion was really divided about Gorbachev, right? So what I want to do is show you first this Pizza Hut commercial, and then another commercial that was made by students from this class and from another class that's kind of a riff on that commercial, which I think demonstrates the kind of connected learning outcomes, none of which are easily quantifiable, but are very valuable. So the ones I think you're going to see are an awareness of cultural historical context, the ability to translate one historical moment to another context. So, you know, kind of mastery, understanding one moment and then recreating it translating it to a different setting.
Это Горбачев.
Горбачев.
Это из-за него у нас в экономике бардак.
Да благодаря ему у нас новые возможности.
Это из-за него у нас политическая нестабильность.
Да благодаря ему у нас свобода.
Полный хаос.
Перспективы.
Политическая нестабильность.
Да благодаря ему у нас есть Pizza Hut.
За Горбачева!
За Горбачева!
За Горбачева! За Горбачева!
Sometimes nothing brings people together like a nice hot pizza from Pizza Hut.
All right, so that's one. And then this is two, and I hope the subtitles come through. So this is a commercial made by students for Grey Cardinal vodka, and we're swapping out Gorbachev for Putin.
Это Путин.
Это Путин.
И заново у нас нет свободы.
То благодарю ему. У нас машинов в мире.
И заново у нас война.
То благодарю ему. У нас крик.
Англия.
Русская гордыня.
Экономические санкции.
Благодарю ему. У нас есть серия.
И ничто не сходит люди вместе, как водки серые кардинал.
За Путина!
За Путина!
За Путина!
За Путина!
Thank you.
Okay, I think that's it.
So do we have more questions for Amy?
I'd like to have her clarify the assessment when she's grading the blocks, like how does she?
So the question is, when you are actually grading the blogs holistically along the lines you said, how do you differentiate? What are the signals to you of excellence?
I look for improvement over the semester. Some of them start at a very impressive level and get better, and so they're going to get a good grade. Some of them have never blogged before and aren't particularly effective writers, but they improve quite a bit. So they get a good grade. I've gone from being a very, I was known as a really tough grader in my former life. And now they feel like they work really, really hard, but everybody's pretty happy with the grade that they get. Because it's all out in public, they can all see what each other is doing. So they have a pretty good sense of whether they're doing well or not. So the answer is that there are lots of A's and B's.
How much time do you dedicate to this class, and how much time do you believe the students are dedicating to this class?
Okay, truth and full disclosure, I spend a lot of time on this class. Not nearly as much as I used to, and now that I've got the editorial team all figured out and some of the mechanics worked out, it's pretty manageable. But I do spend... Well, let me talk about before. I always thought I was a pretty good teacher. I've been teaching for a long time. This is a bread and butter course for me. So my daily course prep used to be, you know, pick up the folder, walk to class, and kind of go for it. And it usually was fine. So I do spend a lot more time now ahead of class, but it's so much more rewarding. Right? I get so much more out of it. I look forward to it. I can't wait to get back on the blogs. I enjoy reading their work. I enjoy my Wednesday night conferences with the editorial team. The students also spend more time than they're used to, and it does take them a while to appreciate that they're not going to benefit unless they are engaged, you know, more than twice a week. But because because it is amplified and because it's out in public, they pick up pretty quickly. So yeah, the bottom line is I do work. It is more work than a conventional course, but it's completely worth it.
So the question is about how many classes you teach, generally speaking, and do you use this approach in all your classes?
I'm on a 2-2. I've been teaching since Gardner left. I've been teaching the new media seminar. I've had that kind of on top of this most of the time. But so a 2-2 or a 2-2.5-2 is kind of my load. I do all my courses like this. If you go to amynelson.net, you'll see the graduate historiography classes that I've done in this format. They don't look quite like this because the goal is a little bit different. But yeah, I can't really imagine going back now. I've turned out. I think this is it.
The new media seminar that Amy is referring to is a faculty development opportunity. I started up at Baylor and did at Virginia Tech, and Amy was not only the logical, but in every dimension, the absolute choice to keep doing it if she was willing after I left. So I think you've done 3 or 4 semesters now since I was there. And basically, it's a seminar with about this many people chosen very deliberately from many different disciplines and also many different organizational positions. So tenured, non-tenured, term, tenure track, people from IT, people from the library, people from various kinds of staff roles. And we do a set of readings, we get together, we talk, we blog about it, and the idea is the set of readings begin to awaken what I call the digital imagination, which has something to do with that paradigm shift that Henry was describing. And the first thing that we always start with is Benny Verbusch's As We May Think, which was the reading assignment for today. and is a way of beginning to think about this not so much as, oh, this is what a laptop does, but, oh, this is what human beings have yearned to do and invented laptops to be able to do, whether or not we live up to that or not. So anyway, Amy's been doing that as well. And I'm not her dean, I'm not her chair, I have no reward for her at all. I guess it must be fun or something. I don't know. I don't want to put words in your mouth, Amy.
Yes to all of the
yes
above.
To all of the above.
It's a labor of love.
Other questions? All right, I'm going to ask one, and maybe this will be the final one, unless it inspires, I don't know, controversy, passion, whatever, and somebody has another one. This is a very basic question. There was a moment you didn't know about any of this. There was a moment you decided to give this a try in a way that was not tentative, but kind of, oh dear, I'm in for it now. You did this and you described what that was like when you went and talked to your students. But now I'm going to ask you, as a professor, an intellectual, a human being with 24 hours in a day, no more. I know you have a family as well, all the competing things. And this, I believe, from what you've told me, was really something different. You were not expecting it that day in the workshop. Can you talk about what prompted you to take that leap? What was it you thought that made you decide maybe it was worth giving it a try? And I'm, you know, I ask this for all sorts of reasons, but it's also a kind of a teacher's question. What happened that made you want to try this, even though you didn't fully understand it beforehand?
Okay, well, Gardner made me want to try this. Gardner gave me the courage and the insight to see that this was worth trying. So I went to that seminar, the faculty development seminar before Deep History and Domestication, because I'd been doing a little web work that hadn't been going very well, and the title was Using Blogging in Your Courses. So I thought, well, why not? But what I wasn't expecting and what was so empowering was the engagement and the the kind of the courtesy and the support and the vision that he provided. He was able to say, you know, yeah, you could do what I think I know what you want, and if you do X, Y, and Z, you might be able to. I bet it'll work. You know, so it was just having a good person in the right place at the right time. I mean, Gardner has a saying, I'm sure you all know, right? When the student is ready, the teacher appears. And, you know, I was ready, but he was there. I really take my teaching, I've always taken my teaching very seriously. I'm very committed to the teaching enterprise. I'm at a Research One institution, Research Matters. I spend a lot of time on my research, but I see them as being very connected, and this has given me a way to integrate my teaching and my research. It feels much more seamless to me now than it ever did. And it was a sea change, but it was an incremental change. So the initial increment was the biggest and most significant one, which was saying to the seminar, we're going to make the course on our blogs. And then everything fell in train from there. So yeah, I think that's how I would answer that.
So I have a quick follow-up, and it's a conscience follow-up.
Okay.
So I'll frame it that way.
Okay.
What has not worked? What has failed? Where in this do doubts arise that are not doubts that have been overcome? What are the places where you go, that isn't working?
Okay, so, well, the lecturing piece, right? You know, the kind of the radical incarnation of this, where that would have decentered the instructor completely. You know, that didn't work. And I tried twice, and I am a little sheepish that I tried it a second time, because they gave me a very stern talking to the second time, and I won't do that again. So that did not work, and it gave me pause. I think the first couple of weeks of the fall of 13 were exciting, but they were really rough. You know, like Ben and I had, I was up until 2 a.m. two nights in a row, and I'm not usually up that late. And Ben was just, you know, we were kind of hanging onto the lifeboat there, but that was just kind of growing pains. I would say the one piece that I would still in, that I hope in a few years will be much easier, I would like to be able to seamlessly toggle between the public distributed conversation and elaboration of the work and direct communication with the author. You know, like I wish I could be reading someone's post and, you know, without having to go to some other interface, I wish I could just say to them, hey, the subject verb agreement in that sentence, you know, isn't right. Can you just, you know, fix that real quick? Or that's actually a photograph of Nazi atrocities, not Stalin atrocities. Can you swap that out before class? So I've got ways to kind of deal with those issues obliquely that account for the public forum, but I would appreciate a back channel. That would be, if I could get that, I'd be very happy.
Anything else you want to say to Amy?
Thank you. Yes. Thank you.
They are all saying that was very helpful. Thank you, Amy.
Ah, well, thank you. Sorry, I was so really hard for me to work without being able to see an audience. So thanks for your patience and for putting up with my addledness and confusion. Like I say, I'm at the end of a long trip and not as together as I often am. But thanks very much for having me in today.